Shooting the shooter, what's good, Chairman Mo? I'm standing here, I'm sitting here in front of the family's share portfolio, right? Our family crown. And also, if you have a look there, there's an orange tree. That's my uncle's, my grandfather's favorite orange tree. I remember growing up. And yeah, always just been naughty around that area. This house that's here and that shack, nyana, they were not there when I was a kid. There used to be a roundabout where the shack is. That essentially used to be a kitchen. And there'd be like a hill that goes down here all the way towards the fence. And so there was like a pathway that goes around the house like that. And I think I chose this location now because I want to talk about this exciting journey where Chairman goes and looks at property and how to help you guys, or how to discuss and position property in your portfolio, you know? I think it's one of those bittersweet type investments that you kind of have to accept that it's one of the lesser evils when you look at what it is that we lack in discipline. And I think maybe from the podcast that I was interviewed in before I started my own YouTube channel, I think in particular the one that comes to mind is Village Trader with own Jabs Njabulo. They essentially were talking about the concept of what's a good strategy and how to come up with your own investment philosophy and that sort of thing. And one of the distinct things that we mentioned was a key to a philosophy was it needed to be something that you can stick to. That's a good investment philosophy. So if you go through the number of philosophies, you'd have growth investing, where you're buying a Tesla, Nvidia, Bitcoin, if you like. And it's very easy for everybody to see that if you had invested $10,000, 10,000 rands in one of those companies today, 5 years, 10 years down the line, and you just love that, 10 years down the line, you'd be balling, you know? The problem is almost nobody ever holds for that 10-year period. So it ends up being an impractical strategy to expect that you will hold a share that goes up 50% every 6 months for 10 years. We human, we have fear and we have greed. So we want to. And fear will always essentially win. Those of you that have done psychology, philosophy, you'll understand that in the battle between the pursuit of pleasure and the avoidance of pain, our ability to keep on going in pursuit of pleasure is far, far, far inferior of our pursuit of avoiding pain. So survival instincts. And obviously it makes sense why that's the case. So that speaks for the growth methodology. Then some others that I can think of would be, I'm a value investor, for example. Value investors work, investing works a bit more because at least in that instance, you don't have to hold something that is growing so quickly that you feel out of touch. But on the other hand, the tough thing that it expects and wants from you is that you must have long withdrawal periods. So a share will be down 40-50% at times, and you must be comfortable holding that share for a good 2-4 years. I'm looking at some of the portfolios that I have, where, for example, Louis is currently at 56 rand. I was buying Louis at 15 rand, 18 rand, 24 rand. So more than half what it is now for a good 5 years before this period now, where the share has gone up and portfolios are green and I look good and I'm happy, you know. Robex Limited. It's a share that's currently, I think, close to 40 rand. When I picked up Robex Limited, it was about 10, 12 rand. And at that point, nobody was talking about it. Nobody knew about it. But it had been listed for more than 40 years, I think, or 20 years. Yeah, 40 years, I think, with 40 years straight profits, little to no debt, that sort of thing. But again, the challenge is we're human. And for 4 years, a share not moving, not doing anything, it's unnatural for most of us. And what I can, I think, realistically expect for you guys and from you guys, right? Then you get dividend investing. Dividend investing essentially involves buying shares that have got that pay good dividends. I think in that regard, the only challenge that you'd find there is that it's difficult, mainly because dividends fluctuate, and a lot of the time the dividend as a sole indicator is not a reliable yardstick for a company that will keep paying and keep growing dividends, especially in, I mean, in South Africa, for example. We are dealing with a very, I'll call it an illiquid market. So we're in an environment where the information availability is only coming on board now, that sort of thing. So you have a situation where for you to be able to be a long-term dividend investor, most people don't have the ability and discipline to keep investing and then to hold out till that portfolio hits 1 million, 2 million, 3 million for you to reap the dividends. So you basically end up with strategies that can work. They've proven themselves to work, but now the philosophy or the human nature that allows the human being to hold it isn't there. And so I think that's through that lens that I then I think accepted or relented that, well, if here's an asset class that ties you up so much in contracts and has such a high bar for entry. So for example, before you buy a property, you must have transfer fees, and they will fund 50% of those transfer fees or the bond registration and not the transfers. And you must pay rates and taxes and levies on it every month. The interest, I think you guys have seen the calculations where for the first 7 years or 10 years in some instances, you're just paying off the interest and nothing else. Even with that, I think because it's somewhat defined shares or defined goal and predictable cash flows, most people are willing to bite that bullet and then just go ahead and invest in it. And I think largely because then at the end of a certain period, they can point at it and say, look, there's my 500,000 rand that I've put, excluding costs. And I think that makes property a, who's the Scott Galloway calls it a forced savings account, that most people wouldn't have the ability over a 3 to 5 year period to save 200,000 rand, 300,000 rand, and just watch it grow, or watch it, as I've spoken in the different methodologies, watch it earning 6% interest, 8% interest. I think it's not the interest that they're unhappy with, it's more the availability of the cash that they're unhappy with. So all the negatives of property are actually a positive because they lock you in, they force you to be in there and just hold it. And I think preliminarily, that for me is the only rationale that I see for why property would be included or would be necessary in your portfolio as a start. I think as time goes, I will do a longer version or longer form of the video of the asset class, discussing the strategies, the benefits of property, what you can use to do with it. Obviously at a premium. In other words, all these costs that you pay up front and all these costs that you pay on the tail end. But I think as a start, it's just for me to say that I am understanding why, from a philosophy perspective, that security that people speak about is there. It's coming at a heavy cost, but I think it is there. You can't ignore the fact that people are doing it. It's a reality. It's not a one day it'll crash. Repositions don't get publicized, stock market crashes get publicized, whatever, the whole psychology of a community, of a society, and the societies that we're from is built around securing or creating safety around holding property, even if it's by perception. And so based on that, I think it becomes a lot easier from a human nature to just go with the flow and have the property. Preliminarily, again, my advice would be don't max out your affordability. So if you afford 1 million, 2 million, 3 million, go for something 1/3 of what you afford or half of what you afford, but leave yourself leeway and room to breathe. And again, I would even say if you can even go lower, 10%, 20%, you know, get a 200,000 rand property and pay it off in a year or 2 years, then you can point at your 200,000 rand, and then do that two or three times over the span of 5 years, then you've got 600,000 rand that you wouldn't have saved otherwise, because it's not accessible to you. And then it becomes easier now to essentially liquidate that and put it in shares if you need to, or rebond half of each and take 300,000 and put it in shares, or whatever it may be. I think there is a strategic play to use property to get into shares, even if it's inefficiently so and hugely expensively so. But from a psychology and a realistic expectation that you won't fiddle with the investment, I think those are the beginning tenets of property making sense in your portfolio. I'm Chairman Mo. I'm gonna keep this under 15 minutes. Those of you that know me know how seldom that is or how rare that is. And that's simply because I just want to enjoy being home. And I mean, I'm enjoying the clucking of the chickens and the footprints. I'm impressed when I look at the ground. I think there's a video where I spoke about tracking, and I'm just impressed when I see the hive of footprints on here. I'll show you guys now. And then the last one is the skyline. So if you look at behind me there, I don't think it'll be as clear on video, right? And especially if you look at those mountains there, right? So when you're here, it's a lot clearer. That clear line, I mean, you're easily looking at over 10 kilometers away. And for me, and why I've always spoken about, if you're a man, you should own a farm and you should own land and you should be one with nature. Those are some of the things that I'm speaking about to say, you can't imagine the mental development, the psychological, the strength of positions, the long-term thinking benefits of being able to see that far with your eye, you know. Wherever you are, Joburg, Pretoria, Cape Town, Durban, I implore you to just look, go outside and see how far can you see and how clear is that, and does that allow you to basically look and think and plan in between? Because if that isn't happening, there's a certain dividend that you're not reaping from our ability as men and as men to be able to think and plan far ahead, to be able to be clear-minded, to be able to go to that quiet place in your head whenever you need to make critical decisions and just think, you know. I like to say I'm self-created claustrophobic. So if I'm sitting in an environment that the buildings are on top of each other, the traffic is on top of each other, the people are on top of each other, that sort of thing. And I'm not talking from a community perspective. You know the environment I'm talking about in the cities. Your thinking becomes clouded, you know. It becomes rushed, it becomes more survivalistic than it does become expanded and expansive. And that's a very dangerous position from which to make decisions on a continual basis, on a sustained basis, and especially long-term type decisions. So I think I just wanted to share that as well, and also give myself permission to log off sooner than maybe you guys would have wanted me to. There is a lot I can still say on the topic. I think as far as it comes to property, I'll say it's not completely financial advice. Speak to your financial advisor, myself included, that sort of a thing, and we can come up with more tailored strategies for using property to actually amp up your share portfolio and keep you disciplined and keep you in there to be able to hold the better investment long term. But I think in terms of the ability to just sit on a pile of cash that does nothing, I think property, I can accede that it is that forced savings that we've been looking for as a people. I'm Chairman Mo. I'm gonna walk out with the footprints of chickens, as you can see on the ground. This is essentially a karyo as they call it. It's a mesh of different lives and livelihoods that cross paths. And if we had the time, I'd be able to tell you which one came first and which one did what and what sort of battles were here. And you can see some of them are bigger and smaller than the others. So you can tell that the ones that have got cheeks and that sort of thing. And then just close off with my granddad's orange tree. Older than most people. It's older than 30 years, I think. Chairman Mo out.